Good morning and welcome to worship at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Walkersville, Maryland. We are glad you're with us today. From me, I just want to announce that Dolores Den has entered the church triumphant. Her funeral will be December 17th at 1 o'clock here in the church. So those of you who knew Dolores, and obviously I know she spent a lot of time in the choir, please come and join us and keep the family in your prayers. And now I'll turn it over to Russ.
Good morning. I got enough for a notebook this morning, so be prepared. As our normal St. Paul's tradition, we'll be collecting a gift for Pastor Phil and his family. So any donations you want to make, you can give it to me, any council member. Won't be Amy because she's got gallbladder surgery
bathroom
this week, so we won't see her for a minute. But just pass those on to us.
We're doing another one today.
All right, today's Ministry Sunday. So anybody that wants to, you don't have to join one of the groups, but you can come back and sit in on it, see if there's anything you want to do to help out. So we've got that out there. I want to thank everybody that helped with Chris Kindle yesterday. I thought it went really great. We had a lot of people come through the church and the parish hall, and we have leftover stuff to sell. There's sausages, roasted nuts, some baked goods left over. Kay will be handling that after the service, so you can take advantage of that. So we had somebody come out, a company come out and look at our stained glass windows, and we've got 19 that are in real need of repair. So it's a lot, but to take care of all 19 windows, it's $60,000. So we're not asking you to shell out for that today. So, but unfortunately, the worst one of all, right there. So nobody really notices it, but then when somebody says that, you start looking, you can see pinholes in it, and it actually needs a historical restoration. That sounds expensive. It is. So it's $21,000. So out of that $60,000, $21,000 is that they're actually going to remove it, take it back to their shop, completely rebuild it, make it like new, and then come back, replace it, put a new protective cover over it, a new light, because part of the issue is the heat from the light in the back. And while it's gone, it could take up to a year. So while it's gone, they actually make a glass copy of it and put it in here. So you won't really notice the difference. That way we don't have to have a piece of plywood up there for a year. We did get a substantial donation already to doing the work on that window. So we're a good bit of the way there. But if you feel called to make a donation towards that, you can put in the offering and just mark it as stained glass. And then we'll try and get that done as soon as we can. The hat and mitten tree is up over around the corner. So if you want to make any donations till that, I think it's till the 16th, is that right? Okay, sounds like a good number. On the 18th of December, there's gonna be an event at Victoria Park if you want to join. We're gonna do a chili cook-off and bingo. So you get chili and bingo. It's gonna be at 1 o'clock. If any of you are interested in joining, you can talk to Belinda and she can give you all the pertinence on that. And then if you have time you want to donate, which we would really appreciate it, we have two council positions open for next year that we need to get filled. Keith Horton and Jackie Waz have agreed to go for a second term, but we do have two other open positions, and we'd like to get that filled before the annual meeting for sure, because we can't take any nominations from the floor. So if you have any questions about council or, you know, can I handle it? Do I want to handle it? You do. You do want to handle it. Trust me. But you can talk to any council member, talk to me, and we can get you any answers you need. Oh, okay, let's do that. Any council members that are here, go ahead and stand up so we can see who you are. Very true. Yep. All right. All right, so there's all your contacts. And also, we're still looking for a treasurer. So Amy's been doing it for a long time. and she's ready to pass it on. So if anybody is interested in that, talk to me and I will pass the information on. All right, I think that's it. You've heard enough from me.
Check that before you start out.
Please stand as you're able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace with your neighbor.
Peace be with you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Of God and for the unity.
As we light our candles for Advent, I remind you that the first candle symbolizes hope and sometimes called the prophecy candle, in remembrance of the prophets, especially Isaiah, who foretold the birth of Christ. It represents the expectation felt in the anticipation of the coming Messiah. And the second candle represents faith. It is sometimes called the Bethlehem candle, as a reminder of Mary and Joseph's journey to Bethlehem. Let us pray. Stir up our hearts, Lord God, to prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, nurture our growth as people of repentance and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
That was very good. Thank you for sharing your talent with us. The first reading for the second Sunday of Advent comes from the 11th chapter of Isaiah, verses 1 to 10. The introduction to the reading. Isaiah the prophet describes the coming of a future ideal ruler who will renew David's royal line, the stump of Jesse. Gifted by the Spirit of God, this ruler will reign with perfect justice. Enmity and danger will be restored to harmony and peaceful coexistence. The first reading. A shoot shall come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of an asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall require of him, and his dwelling will be glorious. Here ends the first reading, the word of the Lord. Today's psalm is from Psalm 72. We will read it responsively by the half verse. The psalm. Give the king your justice, O God,
and your righteousness to the king's son,
that he may rule your people righteously,
and the poor with justice,
that the mountains may bring prosperity to the people,
and the hills in righteousness.
Let him defend the needy among the people,
rescue the poor and crush the oppressor.
May he live as long as the sun and the moon endure,
from one generation to another.
Let him come down like rain upon the mown field,
like the showers that water the earth.
In his time may the righteous flourish,
and let there be an abundance of peace till the moon shall be no more.
Blessed are you, Lord God, the God of Israel.
You alone do wondrous deeds.
And blessed be your glorious name forever.
And may all the earth be filled with your glory. Amen. Amen.
The second reading for today comes from the 15th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans, verses 4 to 13. Introduction to the reading. God's promise to include Gentiles within the circle of God's blessed people has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Christians live out their unity by welcoming and encouraging each other, just as Christ has welcomed them into God's family. The second reading. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the Scriptures, we may have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Jesus Christ, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, and the one who rises to rule the Gentiles, in him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here ends the second reading, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the third chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord and make his way straight. Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all of Judea were going out to him in all the region around the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for the baptism, he said to them, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our ancestor. For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to even carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you,
during these weeks of Advent, we are moving steadily toward Christmas, the celebration of the birth of Christ. The very Christmas fact that he was born, of course, actually born a human being, is of great significance. Significance we may not always fully appreciate. For while it is true that Jesus Christ is truly and fully the Son of God, with all that implies for the certainty of our salvation, he is at the same time also and fully a human being. The prophetic name he bore was Emmanuel, God with us. Both halves of that name deserve emphasis. God, the consuming fire we heard in our readings, awesome in the grandeur of his majesty and infinitely able to help us in our needs. And yet God with us. In a way even more dramatic and assuring than what Jacob once envisioned. In Jesus Christ, God has come to us as one of us, a human being. That Christmas fact is so obvious that we may take it for granted, not fully understanding its deep and wondrous meaning. And when the time had fully come for God to send a Savior into the world, why did he send his own dear son? And why as a human being? Why was that necessary?
Sometimes a great truth is better understood if one considers an alternative.
I beg your pardon?
Would it help you to your understanding of the meaning of the Lord's incarnation if you tried for a moment to imagine his doing it in a different way?
How do you mean?
Well, why don't you suppose, for the sake of argument, that instead of sending his own son as a human being, born of the Virgin Mary, God had decided to effect your salvation some other way?
Like what?
Well, perhaps by sending one of his holy angels to be your savior.
Like you, for example?
Why not? You already know my name.
Gabriel.
Right. Take the matter of prayer, for example.
Prayer?
Have you ever imagined that it would be what it would be like to pray to a savior who was not a human being, but an angel instead?
No, I haven't. Would it help to try?
Only if you remember that we are just pretending for purposes of illustration and understanding. You wouldn't really pray to me.
Well, that's right, but with that in understanding, let's give it a try.
All right. I'll play your little game if you think it'll help.
How shall we begin?
Well, pretend you are praying to an angel who is your savior.
Like dear savior Gabriel?
We're just pretending, please remember. You may proceed.
Dear savior Gabriel, my mother is in a nursing home, getting older and more feeble, not doing very well at all, and I'm concerned about her.
My dear believer, I'm sure that, in your eyes at least, this is indeed a serious problem. Concern about one's parents is certainly in keeping with the directives in the commandment, honor your father and mother. Keep up the good work. Unfortunately, never having had a mother of my own, I'm afraid I don't fully understand what you must be going through right now. We angels don't have those kinds of family ties, you know. They must be terrible, or maybe they're wonderful. I really wouldn't know.
Gabriel, I'm not doing so well either. My gallbladder has been acting up a bit. My arthritis is bothering me.
That's because you have a body, don't you see? And bodies are subject to things like that. So I've been told. I wouldn't know myself, of course. We angels are ministering spirits, you know. Not tied down with awkward things like arms and legs and hearts and livers and hair and teeth and fingers and toes.
Things aren't going well at work either. They've had to let quite a few people go, and now a strike is being threatened.
Oh, you mean work as in labor? We angels do serve the Lord, of course. That's our job. But we don't regard it as a job, not the way you define it. And since we don't age in heaven, we don't have retirement problems or unemployment or job dissatisfaction either.
Well, I'm dissatisfied with the way I've been coping, not just here at work, but everywhere. My fuse has been awfully short lately, and I'm afraid I've lost it a time or two. I'm just not getting along with other people the way that I should.
Never having lost my temper myself.
Okay, I know. You wouldn't understand.
Well, it's not that I don't care.
Right. But if I told you, for example, that I've been goofing off a bit lately, you know, loafing, not working up to my capacity, not coming anywhere near to fulfilling my potential, you really don't understand, do you?
Sorry.
And I'm not getting any younger. It isn't comfortable to find myself suddenly the older generation and to keep going to funerals of people who are more or less my contemporaries. Death, you know?
No, I don't know.
And if I were to talk about temptation, sin, and guilt, we could go on and on like this, but the point has probably been made, a point that is most forcefully in the letter to the Hebrews. that book of the New Testament which begins, "In many and various ways God spoke of old to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by a son."
The first chapter of that epistle, by the way, goes on to demonstrate that Jesus Christ, the Son through whom God has spoken in these last days, is superior to angels.
"For to what angel did God ever say, 'Thou art my Son, today I have begotten thee'?"
Yes, like that.
Then toward the end of the fourth chapter, the epistle makes our point, the point that Christmas makes, how important, how comforting it is for us to have a Savior who is one of us, a human being. "For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses."
The way an angel might be, unable to sympathize.
"But one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin."
Who understands the way an angel never could, because he's lived your life for you? He understands things like family, concerns, illnesses and injuries, work and duty, disappointment and temptation, the awful consequences of human sin.
"He even died for us, for sin."
An angel couldn't die for you the way your human Savior did.
That's you.
"For you, as once he earns to live right here among us, one of you, a human being, Emmanuel."
God with us.
In order to help people understand the kingdom of heaven, Jesus once put a little child in the midst of them.
Just as he himself once came as a child in the midst of us.
And so the rest of that important word of God becomes a message you should hear. And trust as well.
"Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need."
A good place to begin that drawing near might well be the Christmas manger,
where Christ, the Son of God, was born, was truly born a human being, one who understands and sympathizes, and yet the Son of God, who by his death and resurrection is able to do even more than sympathize.
Which is already more than an angel could do.
But to offer grace to help in time of need.
So pray with confidence and trust. The Lord to whom you pray is one who truly understands and has the power to help. Emmanuel.
God with us. Amen. affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for a world that yearns for new hope. God, you renew the church in every age. We give thanks for hymn writers and theologians. Inspire teachers, writers, and musicians to delight and instruct your people. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You give us a vision of creation in harmony, when hurting and destruction will be no more. Teach us to be stewards of the earth and companions to its creatures. Restore to balance and wholeness what human greed has harmed. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You defend the cause of all who are poor and oppressed. Raise up leaders who will govern with equity and serve the common good. Guide judges, lawmakers, and public officials to protect the rights of those who cannot advocate for themselves. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You deliver those in need from suffering and fear. Come to the aid of any who are exploited or abused, especially children, elders, and victims of human trafficking. Provide safety and help to our neighbors without shelter, refugees, and those fleeing violence. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You urge your people to welcome one another as you have welcomed us. Nurture ministries of hospitality and care in this and every congregation. We pray for people who are homebound, hospitalized, or separated from loved ones, especially Lillian, Bruce, Jim, Doug, Mark, Michael, Joe, Chris, Sharon, Lila, Jack, Corey, Noah, Bob W., those on our prayer list and those whom we name in our hearts or out loud. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You embrace all who have died, trusting in your promises, and we give thanks for their faithful witness, especially Dolores Den. Sustain us in hope until we are united with them in the joy of your eternal presence. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all your children. In Jesus' name, amen. We're thankful for the gifts you share with your church and ask you to continue to do so.
Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Blessed are you, maker of all things. As you've entrusted us with all that you have created, now gather our gifts, nourish us with this sacrament, and send us to those who hunger and thirst. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give us thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Amen.
Gathered into one with the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome at Christ's table. Come as you are. The feast is prepared. The table is set. Come and eat. Thank you. Please stand as you're able. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
We give you thanks, most gracious God, that you have fed us with the bread of heaven and given us a foretaste of paradise. Enliven us to be your body in the world and to serve those who are in need. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The God of peace, who creates all things and calls them good, who makes us alive in Jesus and who breathes on us the spirit of hope, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is near.
Thanks be to God.